to Athens.
After over a century, the Olympic Games finally returned to their ancient birthplace and the city of their revival. Bridging 3,000 years, the nation that is the mother of Western civilization proudly displays its history and culture to the world. Greece is the smallest country to hold the Summer Olympics since Helsinki, Finland in 1952. And Athens will host a record 11,000 athletes from 202 nations.
Our world today is in need for peace. Athletes, show us that sport unites by overriding national, political, religious, and language barriers. May the Games be held in peace, in the true spirit of the Olympic truce that was created here.
Greece's President Konstantinos Stephanopoulos officially opens the games of the 28th Olympiad.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic flame, la flamme olympique, the Olympiaki flora.
Greek civilization has considered man the measure of all things. And here in Athens, the men and women athletes will compete not just for their nations, but as citizens of the world. And for the next 16 days, the world will be the better for it. The sport of fencing has evolved over the ages from ancient forms of combat. Its legendary stories of dueling heroes have enchanted young and old alike. Fencing is one of only five sports to be contested at every Olympics since the revival in 1896. Women first competed at the 1924 Paris Olympics in the foil. Now, 80 years later in Athens, for the first time in Olympic history, women will compete in the saber. The saber is the modern version of the slashing cavalry sword. The difference between saber and the other swords, the foil and the épée, is that the fencer can use the edge of the blade as well as the tip to score points. Each bout can consist of three rounds. The winner is the fencer who scores 15 points first. It is 6:30 p.m., the evening of August 17th, the semifinals of the inaugural women's saber competition. Of the four women competing tonight, two are Americans. This alone is an historic moment, for it guarantees that for the first time in Olympic fencing history, a medal will be won by an American woman. The first American semifinalist is 21-year-old Seda Jacobson, the number one ranked fencer in the world. The other is 19-year-old Mariel Zagunas. As the two fencers prepare for their bouts, there is an additional chance for history to be made this night. Not since the 1904 St. Louis Games, 100 years ago, has an American, male or female, won a gold medal in fencing. Before the competition began, there was a hope that there might be three Americans competing in the final round. The third American fencer was Emily Jacobson, Seda's younger sister and Marielle's best friend. Unfortunately, Emily was eliminated from the competition in an earlier round by Leonora Peru of France. While Seda Jacobson is considered the favorite based on her number one ranking, much attention is on Mariel Zagunas, for her journey to the games has been difficult and her presence here is somewhat of a surprise. Just 5 months earlier, the U.S. fencing team competed in a final World Cup meet in Italy, a final chance for fencers to earn points that would determine the U.S. team.
This was the last qualifying event for the Olympic Games. Seda was already on the team. She was ranked number one in the world. She was automatic. In the semifinals of this event, by chance, Seda drew Mariel Zagunas. And what it had come down to on this day was, if Mariel had beaten Seda in the semifinals and made the finals, Mariel was guaranteed to be on the Olympic team, as was Seda.
Mariel and I ended up having to fence at one point, and if I won, then Emily was going to qualify, and if Mariel won, then she would qualify. And I didn't even know what was at stake. My coach didn't tell me.
But the way it worked out, that in the semifinals, Mariel was up 14-12 on Seda. As it turned out, Seda came back and scored the last three touches to win, basically putting her sister on the team and maintaining her seat at the Thanksgiving dinner table at the Jacobson family.
It came down to the last bout of the last tournament, of the last touch, the last few seconds, everything. It was just like realization that I wasn't, you know, gonna make it and stuff, and losing the bout and everything on top of that. It was definitely very devastating.
Mariel is definitely one of our best friends, and it was definitely something that we wanted to do together, and I couldn't imagine being there without her.
Having failed to qualify for the United States team, Mariel is now the highest-ranked fencer in the world not competing in the Olympics. This gives Mariel the chance to serve as an alternate in the event that a fencer withdraws from the competition.
She never gave up hope. She continued to train just as hard, because she said she didn't want to be not in the best shape of her life. Even one of the Americans gets sick, injured, or needs to withdraw.
A few weeks later, as the Olympic team prepared for its trip to Athens, Mariel was invited to take part in a team function.
The team photograph was actually taken the third week in April at the U.S. National Championships in Atlanta. It was very awkward, because first we took a picture without Mariel, because she wasn't on the team, and then we took one with Mariel, because we knew there was a chance if someone got injured or withdrew, she would be the next person put into the games. The sad part was, is if you look at Mariel, her eyes are very expressive, always smiling. Her face is always smiling. And on this day, she really was dead woman walking. She walked around with a blank stare. We all felt terrible for her, and we knew how bad she felt.
Marielle continues competing and wins her first World Cup competition in Germany. While traveling home, she learns that the Nigerian fencer has withdrawn from the Olympic saber event. Based on world ranking, the federation names Marielle as the Nigerian's replacement. She will now compete in Athens.
When we found out that, that was pretty exciting, and then I knew that my dream could finally at least have a chance of becoming a reality, then I started being, okay, now it really can happen, so I'm gonna go for it.
Now here in Athens, in the first semifinal bout, Sada Jacobson will face 20-year-old Tan Shue of China, the 2002 world champion. As expected, Sada starts quickly, but Tan proves to be a formidable opponent. Sada leads at the break by only a point, 8-7.
This was definitely a person that, on any given day, I definitely could beat and have beaten in the past. Suddenly, everything seemed a lot more stressful. You know, everybody's watching you in the final.
In the second round, the momentum shifts in Tan's favor. Sada finds herself in an unfamiliar position. She trails Tan 14-12. If Tan wins another point, she will advance to the gold medal bout. Tan wins. Sada leaves the arena. With her dream of winning the gold medal over, she must now prepare for the bronze medal bout in 2 hours' time.
It was so hard, you know, sitting there and seeing everything that you've worked for is gone, and knowing that you still have to go out and fence again. And I just remember sitting in the chair with my head in my hands, crying, and my coach came up to me. He was just so supportive and saying, this is sport and this is what happens. You're not gonna get the gold, but you still have a chance for a medal.
In the other semifinal, Marielle Zagunas faces the 10th seed, Catalina Gheorghe-Shuea of Romania. Marielle takes control of the bout from the start. She easily defeats Gheorghe-Shuea by a score of 15-10. Marielle Zagunas will now battle for the gold medal. Sada Jacobson returns for the bronze medal bout. She easily defeats Gheorghe-Shuea of Romania, 15-7. Sada wins the bronze medal. It is 9:30 p.m., the women's final in the saber competition. Marielle Zagunas will face Tan Shue. The two finalists have never faced each other before in an individual competition. Marielle wins the first 2 points.
Marielle got off to a fast start. She was using every aspect of her game. She was using an attack, she was using a great defense, and she was also utilizing a line, when you stick your line out and sort of tell your opponent, okay, here it is, do something to it.
With each lunge, Marielle builds a commanding lead. At the break, she leads 8-2. Tan becomes stronger in the second round. She keeps pace with Zagunas, but is unable to cut into Marielle's earlier lead. Marielle scores again and now leads 14-8. She is 1 point away from the gold medal. Marielle strikes for what appears to be the final point. But the referee awards the point to Tan. The score is now 14-9. In the stands, tension is building amongst her teammates and family.
I have to be frank, while we thought Marielle would win, we were waiting for lightning to strike, because in U.S. fencing, it always seems that it had. We're all sitting there with goose pimples and everything. We just couldn't believe that this, can the referee change the call? Will something happen? Will it be a protest? Have we finally won the Holy Grail, the gold medal?
Thank you. Mikhail Zagunis wins the gold medal.
She scores a touch, and we ran onto the stage ready to throw her up. And almost out of a bad dream, we went up. She jumped off the stage to shake the referee's hand.
The rules indicate that after the bout, when you salute again, you also have to shake your opponent's hand. You have to shake the referee's hand. Because I see my teammates, like, running at me, and I'm like, I have to do this before they tackle me. So I ran over to her, shook her hand. I jumped off the stage, run over, shake the referee's hand, and then he still, like, pulled me back because he thought that I didn't salute everybody.
I don't think it was anything that any of us ever expected or even thought about until, you know, those last few touches. And I was saying to myself, oh my God, Marielle's gonna be Olympic champion. It was one of the most exciting things that in my fencing career, definitely watching that happen.
Later that evening, the medal ceremony takes place. Seda Jacobson of the United States has awarded the bronze medal. Tan Shuhe of China receives the silver. Mariel Zagunis is awarded the gold. For the first time in 100 years at the Olympic Games, the national anthem is played for an American fencer. And for Mariel Zagunis, it is a time to reflect on all she has accomplished. For in just 5 months, she has made the journey from obscurity to Olympic immortality.
I think it all came to a head when they finally played the national anthem. Because in fencing competitions, we'd heard everyone else's anthem to the point where we almost know them by heart. So finally, we weren't hearing someone else's anthem. We weren't hearing our anthem for another sport. We were hearing our anthem for our sport. And I know we were all sitting there crying, and I get a little choked up just talking about it now.
At the moment that I was on the medal stand and had gotten the gold medal, still, it hadn't really sunk in. All I could really think is that, you know, I did it. It's great, like, just an incredible feeling. And I was still in disbelief at that point.
Thank you.